Welcome, everybody. You just entered into the winning zone.
Winning zone. Winning zone.
Today, I will be taught the word of God. My mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I am ready to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I will never be the same. In Jesus' name, amen. You just entered into the winning zone.
Winning zone.
Winning zone.
Oh, oh,
good morning, Sammy.
I'm living in the overflow.
Oh,
oh, expect the supernatural.
I'm blessed.
the sound of revival. Let heaven roar and fire fall. Come shake,
shake the ground,
the sound
of revival.
Let heaven roar and fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival. Let heaven roar and fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound with your love. Let heaven roar and fire fall. Come shake the ground, yeah, with the sound.
He's perfect. He's perfect in this too. Yeah, I hear your mind in that too. It don't matter what you're going through. Yes, he's perfect. He will perfect that which concerns you.
Welcome to Summit Church Online. I tell you what, we've got a powerful experience for you today. I want you to know that no matter what you've done, no matter how many mistakes you've made in the past, that you stand before God today, approved, accepted, because of what Jesus has done for you on the cross. And that's what I'm going to share about today in my message. Got some powerful praise and worship for you. I want you to know that you're in a judgment-free zone today. There is now no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. God is not condemning you. He's not mad at you about anything. God loves you unconditionally. I don't believe that you're tuning in to this by accident. God has something just for you, so don't leave. Stay right here, because we're going to help you. We're going to help you to overcome these condemning voices, no matter where they come from. Have you ever been accused? Somebody say something about you, accuse you of things. And even if you've done some things that were wrong, and you know they were wrong, and there are true accusations, I want you to know what to do about that and how God sees you. You stand before God approved, and God rejects every accusation against you, even if they were true. So let's take you right into today's experience so you can receive what God has for you today. Are y'all ready for the word? Man, I tell you what, there's a strong anointing on me to teach right now, and I am ready. You said you're ready. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Welcome to Summit Church, y'all. Everybody, everybody watching online. I was teaching one evening on Thursday night, and I forget what exactly I was specifically speaking on at the time, but I made a statement. I asked the people there, isn't there a song, I Stand Approved? And somebody said, no, it's I Stand Accused. And I got blessed because it showed me how much my mind is renewed. I would just flip a song title and make it say what the word, you know, change it to make a statement based on the word of God. And so I found out that there was a song back in the day. If you're a little younger than me, you probably have never even heard of the song. Anybody, you're telling your age if you know it. You ever heard the song or heard about the song? I don't even remember the lyrics or the tune or the melody or nothing like the music of it. But there's a song, I Stand Accused. Everybody being quiet like, oh, I don't know. Amen. Matt knows what I'm talking about. So anyway, I've got a message for you today. I stand approved. Being approved is a big deal. And God has built into us the need of approval. One of the things that I believe drives Facebook is the need for approval. And there are a lot of people that are addicted to Facebook? And one of the reasons why that I believe that Facebook is so appealing is because it's a place where people can get friends, and they can post status, and people like their status, and you can go and see whether or not people like, how many likes you get, people that respond positively to what you post, and if somebody says something negative or disagrees with something you post, you don't like that too much. I don't like it. And I'm not against Facebook. I'm on Facebook. But God doesn't want us to go to social media, to Facebook, to get our approval. But we do have a need for approval. There's a fitness joint that calls themselves, their subtitle is Judgment-Free Zone. That's appealing to a lot of people. It strikes a nerve because people do not want to be judged. And church folk are good at judging. Huh? And that's not how we're going to reach the world, by pointing out people's sin. Because all it does, when you point out sins to people, it just fuels it. It's like adding fuel to the fire. Because the Bible says that the law, and that's what a lot of people are doing, they're pointing out the law to people, like people who have abortion clinics or people who are gay and or whatever. And there are a lot of Christians that are good at pointing out the law to them, waving the Bible at them, okay? But all that does, see, it strengthens sin. How are you going to get these people need to repent? Well, let's do what the Bible says. The Bible says it's the goodness of God that leads people to repentance. Christians should be known, we should be known for our love.
really, this is a whole nother subject. But when it comes to reaching the world, it's the goodness of God, Romans 2:4, that leads people to repentance. We need to show people how good God is, not trying to get people to stop sinning. Because once people, I'm against sin. Don't misunderstand me. And God is against sin. But how do we get people to stop sinning? We tell them how good God is and get them to come into a relationship with Jesus and let the grace of God sort that out in their life. Just keep pointing people to Jesus and his finished work. Yeah. Let the gay folks come into church. Let the two guys hold hands and come on in and sit down and listen to the finished work of Jesus. Amen. Amen. That's not endorsing somebody's sin. See, people are saved by grace through faith. It's not anything we do to get saved, right? It's the gift of God. If you have to earn something to get something, it's not a gift. If you have to do something to get love, it's not unconditional. God's love is unconditional, and the church needs to extend that. That's what the Bible says, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them. Yeah, Pastor, I get it. Once they get saved, or before they get saved, all they got to do is come to God and God will forgive them for their past. But once they get saved now they got a total line. Now they got to do this and do this and do this. That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says, as you receive Christ, so walk in him. How'd you receive Christ? By grace through faith. That's how we ought to walk. God demonstrates his own love for us, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than, having been declared righteous, this is Romans 5, 8, 9, much more than. God loved us when we were sinners. God loved the homosexual. And see, God isn't great on a curve. You might not have been a homosexual, but you were a sinner before you got saved. You're not a sinner because of what you do. You're a sinner because of how you were born. You inherited, we all inherited the sin nature from Adam, and the solution is and always will be Jesus and his shed blood and his finished work. And while we were sinners, while we were still in our sins, even though you weren't here, Christ died for you and took care of all of your sins, past, present, and future. And so what'd you do to get it? Just receive what Jesus has already done. Okay? But some people get that. Oh, yeah. While we were sinners, yes, sinners, Christ died for us. Yeah. And they stop reading. The next verse says, much more than having been justified or having been declared righteous by his blood, we shall be saved from his wrath. Not much less. See, some Christians act like after we get saved, he's going to love you less. No, he's going to love you more. Having been declared righteous, not by your works, you were declared righteous by his blood. You will be saved from his wrath. In other words, God is never going to be angry with you. In fact, he swore in Isaiah 59, he said he swore that He will never be angry with you, and his kindness will not depart from you. He's never going to stop being good to you. And it's not based on your performance. See, being declared righteous by his blood, you should be saved from his wrath. Not by what you do, but because you were declared righteous. But there's a whole lot of self-righteousness going on. Shaking the Bible at people, you know, I'm right, you're wrong. That's not God's way. And it's no wonder why people don't want to come to church, because that's what the majority of the church has been presenting. Well, anyway, that's just extra, but we stand approved. As believers in Christ, Romans 16:10, greet Apelles, approved in Christ. See that? Approved in Christ. We can say, we can put your name in there for Apelles, whatever your name is. I can say, greet Al, approved in Christ. Greetings, y'all, approved in Christ. Well, how do you know? You don't know what I did last night. No, I know what Jesus has done for you on Calvary. Romans 8:1 says, there's now. No condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Some manuscripts, this is the ESV, some manuscripts have a condition to it, who walk not after the flesh but after the spirit. But in a lot of manuscripts, you know, that doesn't even exist. And the ESV doesn't even include it in there, because there is no condition. There is no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus, period, full stop. How many of you are in Christ? You're in a judgment-free zone. I don't care what you've done. Don't let anybody judge you. No preacher, no anybody else. Judge you about anything. Because in Christ, God is not judging you for anything, because all of the judgment was on Jesus. I can't wait to show you some, there's some scripture I'm going to show you in the Old Testament. You're going, you're going to just jump through the roof if you're like me. Any Bible students out there? I want to help you, boy. I'm telling you what we need, and we need to shout this from the rooftops, man. You are approved. See, God doesn't want us to go to Facebook for our approval. Nothing wrong with Facebook. But our approval should be because of what Jesus says about us, what God says about us, what God did for us through Christ Jesus on the cross. We are approved. We got approved stamped on us every day. Our status is approved, righteous, accepted, loved, favored, blessed. That's our status 24/7. Whether you confess it or not, you are approved. That's how God sees you. Second Corinthians 5:21, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us. Jesus took our place on Calvary, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. This is a scripture that I tell you, when you get a hold of this, when you really get a hold of it, it will change your life. We were made righteous because of what Jesus did, not self-righteousness. You need to give up self-righteousness. You're not, what's self-righteousness? Righteousness based on what you do. That's how they were righteous in the Old Testament. By keeping the law. And they could never keep it. And God knew that. That's why he sent Jesus. He gave them the law, and he knew they couldn't keep it. That's why he instituted sacrifices. You ever wonder why he instituted sacrifices? So he could find a way to keep blessing them, because it's always God's heart to bless his people. So he instituted sacrifices so they can bring animal sacrifices on their behalf. And when the priest would examine when they would bring the lamb, the priest would examine, like if this paper here was the lamb here, and the priest would, the person would present the lamb, and the lamb had to be flawless, spotless, without blemish, flawless. Not the person, the sacrifice. And so the priest would examine, because the lamb had to be spotless. Jesus is referred to as the Lamb of God, the Lamb slain before the foundation of the world. These animals were a type of Jesus. Notice, they didn't examine the person. The priest didn't examine the person. They examined the sacrifice. The sacrifice was brought for their sin. Hallelujah. When God looks at you today, when you've sinned, and we all sin, I'm not just talking about the outside stuff inside. Stuff that's in your heart, and maybe some wicked thoughts and things that you're thinking and think. See, God, and the devil will try to accuse you of that, but we'll get to that later. But see, all of that, you're under the waterfall of God's forgiveness all the time. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father who says they're forgiven, they're righteous. And Jesus offered one sacrifice for sins forever. And the Bible says he perfected forever those who are sanctified. Read Hebrews 8, 9, and 10. It'll bless you. So based on that, then, when we sin today, God's not looking at you. He looks at the sacrifice. And the sacrifice is flawless. Oh, hallelujah. And see, when you came to Jesus, this is what's happening here, when you became the righteousness of God in Christ. It's not only as if that wasn't good enough that you've been forgiven. Remember this perfect, flawless lamb? All the righteousness of that lamb was transferred to the person. All the sin of the person is transferred to that lamb. So when we come to Jesus, he became sin for us. All of our sin was transferred to Jesus. All Jesus' righteousness, all of his goodness was transferred to us.
Glory, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah, thank you, Lord. Glory, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, yeah, Lord, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
My goodness. Is that good or what? And it doesn't make it doesn't have anything to do with what I do. Not when I came to Christ, nor afterwards. Now, does that mean I can just go out? Oh, man, if you preach that, that's just going to give people a license to sin. No, it's not. The Bible says that it's the grace of God that will cause sin not to have dominion over you. See, what's the response to that kind of love, that kind of forgiveness, that kind of unconditional love? I don't want to go out and start sinning. You know why I don't? Because that's not my nature. I've been made righteous. I'm clean on the inside. Why would I want, my question to you, why do I want to sin? If my response to that is I want to go out and start sinning when I hear about God's grace, and I'm going out and trying to see how much I can sin, I'm not saved. You need to go back and receive Jesus. How can we? The scripture uses that language. How can we? I might be able to find that. Because it's not your nature to sin. Can you see that? You become a new creation. In fact, if you backed up to verse 17, it says you're a new creation. Old things have passed away. What was inside me that made me sin, it's gone. If I can find it real quick, I'll show it to you. If I can't, you just have to take my word for it. Look it up. Don't take my word for it, but. Yep, here it is. What should we say then? Should we continue in sin? Paul preached grace so strong. See, you're not preaching grace really. You're not preaching grace right unless people ask a question. What you mean we can just sin all we want? Because these folk had this question, and Paul said, look, he asked a question for him. He said, what shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? He said, certainly not, exclamation mark. Certainly not. How shall we? How shall we? Who died to sin, live any longer in it? I love it. Let me give you another reading assignment. Romans 5, Romans 6. And one minister said, I don't do drugs. I do Romans chapter 5. And I love that. For several days, for weeks, I would read Romans 5 every day. Just read it. Just get this on the inside of you. But Romans 6 says, but God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, that's before we were in Christ. See, that's the reason why people that don't know God, see, they can't help it. They're slaves of sin. And the answer is not to give them the law, but to give them grace. Tell them, point them to the cross. Give them Jesus and Him alone. Don't try to get them to stop doing stuff. Give them Jesus, who will radically transform their lives. But God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine to which you were delivered. So you know what? You know what we do? We obey from the heart. Even your obedience, well, we didn't need to obey. It's easy to obey. We obey from the heart because of our nature. Your obedience is really not even of yourself. You obey from your heart. And my heart, referring to here my spirit, doesn't want to disobey. My heart is not going around looking for some sin to get into. Man, I used to smoke weed. I ain't looking to smoke no weed. You understand? I'm like, oh man, I can smoke all the weed I want. God will still forgive me. Why do I want to smoke weed? Why do I want to snort coke? Why do I don't want to do those things. And it's not a struggle. I obey from my heart. I do what I want to do. And I want to do right. Because of in response to the love of God. Man, love will make you do right. I ain't going to say that other part. The love not going to make you do wrong, Al Green. Love will make you do right. The love of God. Amen. Very important that you understand that you're righteous. And righteous means that you are not guilty. You are entirely pleasing to God. All of Jesus, you're not just forgiven because of the cross. Also, all of Jesus' goodness is transferred to you. I'm just trying to be a good person. You are a good person. You're going to start doing good things and good works when you understand that you are good. Don't ever have this mentality or say, well, I'm just trying to be a good person. You are a good person. That's who you are. When you understand that you're righteous, it means that you are entirely pleasing to God. You're not guilty. Let's deal with this self-righteousness thing so you can see the difference. Not by works of Titus 3:5, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. See, it's not by works of righteousness which we have done. This is not how we're saved. We're saved because of what Jesus has done. This is talking about works of righteousness, which we have done, self-righteousness. Paul deals with this also over here in Philippians 3:9. And be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law. See, righteousness of the law was do good, get good. Do bad, get bad. But that which is through, this is the righteousness that we should have, that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which is from God by faith, which is what we read about in 2 Corinthians 5:21. Are y'all with me? Say, I am. The righteousness of God, in Christ. I am approved. I stand approved. I get my approval from God. I am. The righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. I'm a good person. No, I was just talking about me at one time. No, go say it again. Say, I'm a good person. I haven't even got to the scripture I really want to give to you. Gonna make you jump out of your seat, boy. I'm telling you. Watch this. Let me give you another one. David even looked to this. Look forward to the righteousness that you and I enjoy today. David also spoke of this when he described the happiness of those who are declared righteous without working for it. King James says David just described the blessedness of the man to whom God imputes, that's an accounting term, imputes righteousness apart from works. Now, I like this. We are declared righteous without working for it. Now, are y'all ready for this? Let's look at Zechariah chapter 3 from New Living Translation. It says, then the angel, now remember, this is in the Old Testament. Say the Old Testament.
Old Testament.
Now say it with some, say like old, say this is the Old Testament. Now this is not even in the Better Covenant. Watch this. Yeah, that's right. Then the angel showed me Yeshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord. I want to go slow because I want you to see this. This is the high priest who is standing before the angel of the Lord. And the accuser Satan walks up. Now, I know there's a couple things about Satan. He is a deceiver. He tried to deceive us into thinking how big and bad he is, but you know, really, he ain't nothing. He got authority over all his power. And one big thing about him is he's accusing. He's an accuser. So Joshua standing here, Joshua standing here before the angel of the Lord. The accuser Satan was there at the angel's right hand, standing right next to this angel, making accusations against Yeshua. That's what he does. Now this is a big deal now. And really this is true grace teaching really gets down to the root of stuff. The root of why folks are mad, why people are in fear, why people have a lack of motivation or confidence, why people are broke, why people are sick. A lot of that stuff boils down to the fact that they feel condemned. And there's some people that are trying to do a lot of good, like life is a scale. It's like they got bad over on this side of the scale, so they got to do good, do a lot of good stuff to balance the bad stuff. Well, I know I'm immoral and I'm committing adultery and fornication and so forth, but maybe if I give enough to the church, maybe God will look at me and say, you know, that kind of balances your stuff out. That's not how God sees stuff. See, we got to get into this no judgment zone and stop trying to be made righteous and be made right with God by your performance and just receive freely his grace, his unmerited favor. By grace or by his unmerited favor, we're saved. And that's how we live. We live by God's unmerited favor. That's how we walk by faith, faith in his finished work. We don't walk by our performance. Amen. See, y'all jumping ahead of me, man. Y'all reading that verse, man. See, yeah, go back to the other verse. Go back to the other verse. Y'all not even listening to me. Y'all looking at the verse, man. I'm not ready for that verse yet. I'm setting you up. Doggone it. See, y'all just got to read. Y'all just got to go ahead, man. Did y'all listen to anything I said? This is a big deal because Satan, here's what he does. He whispers in your ear. See, there's three different ways you get accused. You get accused by, you know, other people. They're good at that. They're good at pointing out stuff, all the stuff that you've done wrong. They'll label you and stuff and put stuff on you and labels on you, and they see you, they think certain ways, and they judge you certain ways. And you got your own thoughts accusing you. You got, you know, your own thoughts, and that's a big deal too. I mean, you get these thoughts about, oh, man, man, I'm not good enough, and I'm not measuring up, and I didn't do this right, I didn't do that right. And then you got the accuser, you know, he's speaking to you. And you call yourself a Christian. Look how you spoke to your husband. Look how you spoke to your wife. Look at what you just said. That's your boss on the job. You know what the Bible says about that? You call yourself a Christian. Look at this stuff coming out of your mouth. Look at this stuff you're thinking about right now. This stuff kind of goes on all the time, doesn't it? I mean, this is why you have to constantly be taught about grace and how God sees you, because the devil or your own thoughts and other people are constantly pointing out faults and things where you don't, how you don't measure up, and when nobody knows you're thinking this. You could be alone by yourself, or you could be at dinner. You can be with a big group of people, and everybody is having a good time and having a Christmas party or something, a Thanksgiving dinner, and these thoughts. Oh, we're getting into some stuff now because we all get them. So let's talk about it. I mean, because this is the kind of stuff that can keep you from being healed, because you don't see yourself properly. You see yourself as, oh, I'm not deserving, because I'm really not measuring up. I'm not good enough to get healed or to get my financial breakthrough or whatever I need from God. Except I'm really not, you know, I'm flawed. Let's deal with that right now. See, God doesn't see none of that. Now, this is back in, what testament is this in? Here's the devil in the Old Testament making accusations. Now, let's go to verse 2. And the Lord said to Satan, I, the Lord, reject your accusation. This is before Jesus went to the cross. He said, I reject, man. That's what God does in you, on your behalf. When the devil tries to accuse you, God says, this is my chosen child. This is my chosen one. This is one I washed in my blood. They're accepted. They stand approved. I reject your accusations. Listen to this. Even if they're true. It don't make no difference what the accusation is. The Lord rejects Satan's accusations. Yes, the Lord, who has chosen Jerusalem, rebukes you. This man is like a burning stick that has been snatched from the fire. Boy, that's us. So God says, this is my child who I've delivered from death and hell. I reject, Satan, your accusation. That's what God says on your behalf. I reject your accusations. Oh, I love it. Revelation 12. 10 and 11, then I heard a loud voice in heaven. Mm-hmm. Now salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come. For the accuser, here it is again. Here's another witness to show you that Satan is the accuser of our brethren who accused them before our God day and night. That's what he does. You've got, the Bible says we should not be ignorant of his devices. He accuses. He doesn't take Thanksgiving off. Day and night. He's always accusing of stuff. But he'd been cast down. Man, if God rejected those accusations in the Old Testament, how much more does he reject them in the New Covenant? And look at how he says we overcome him. We overcome him by the blood. We overcome him by, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. Look at verse 3. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, the blood that Jesus shed on the cross. Remember the Lamb? Ah, oh, yes. All your sin was transferred to the Lamb. All of the Lamb's righteousness was transferred to you. You weren't examined. The Lamb was examined. And the Lamb was flawless. The Lamb was perfect. We overcome. How do you overcome the devil? By the blood. You want to know how to overcome the devil? So you got to understand he's already defeated. You overcome him by the blood that Jesus shed and by the word of their testimony. What's the testimony? The finished work of Jesus. What Jesus did for us on the cross and his finished work. That's our testimony. Well, not, but it's because I stood up to the devil all night. And no, it's not because of what you did. It's because of the finished work of Jesus. Let's go back over here to Zechariah. You know, he said, this man is like a burning stick that has been snatched from the fire. Yeshua's clothing, verse 3, was filthy as he stood there before the angel. So the angel said to the other standing there, take off his filthy clothes. And turning to Yeshua, he said, see, I've taken away your sins. And now I'm giving you these fine new clothes. Ooh, God took him shopping. He's like, I'm giving you. And this is what he did for us. He took away our sins, didn't he? He removed our sins on the cross, past, present, and future. Let me try to contain myself here. And he's given us some new clothes. You want to look at what those new clothes look like? Isaiah 61:10. I will rejoice greatly in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he has clothed me with the garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness. He has covered you. You got on a robe of righteousness. You are the righteousness of God in Christ. He said, as a bridegroom decks himself with ornaments, as a bride adorns herself with her jewels. Man, we've been adorned. We've been decked out with righteousness. I love it. Ephesians 6. You see what clothes you got? Ephesians 1:6, to the praise of the glory of his grace by which he made us, what? Accepted in the beloved. Beloved is an intimate term. The beloved is Jesus. When Jesus was baptized by John in the River Jordan, he came up out of the water. You know, God said, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. And we're accepted in the blood. We could say we're well pleased. We're well pleasing to God. We're totally acceptable to God in the beloved. Why? Because the beloved is highly favored. The beloved is well pleasing to God. The beloved is accepted. Therefore, we're accepted. Because on the cross, Jesus' goodness was transferred to us. You don't have to fear about when you come before God. Well, all I want to do when I stand before God, when I meet Jesus, I want to hear, well done. I don't want to hear, well. I want to hear, well done, you good and faithful servant. Man, I want to work so I can be that good and faithful servant. So he'll say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Now, I don't have to do that because God looks at Jesus and said, well done, you good and faithful servant. And I am in him. And when I stand before God, he's going to say, well done. He's going to say about you, well done, good and faithful servant. Because not because you were good and faithful, but because Jesus was good and faithful. And that was transferred to you. Colossians 1:21, if that Zechariah scripture didn't bless you, this will. Now, I know that that bless you, man. Isn't that good? No, this goes along with that. You're free from accusation. It's a judgment-free zone we're living in right now. So I didn't always know this. I tell people, you know, the reason why you're not blessed, you know, you haven't been coming to church like you should, man. You haven't been doing this. No, we're not blessed because of our performance. We're blessed because of what Jesus has done for us. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. See, that was in the Old Testament by your evil. Excuse me, I was reading the wrong translation there. Okay, this includes you who were once far away from God. That was in the Old Testament. You were his enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions. But watch what happened. Yet now, say now, he has reconciled, God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them. Yet now he has reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ. It is finished. In his physical body. As a result, he has brought you into his own presence, and you are holy and blameless, and you stand before him without a single fault. When God looks at you, he sees you without a single fault. No, okay, watch this. NIV says, once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. Verse 22. You got your shopping clothes on? Yeah. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish, and free from accusation. Yeah. Now, wait, hold on. Without blemish? Do you see that? Can we say flawless? If I don't have any blemish, I'm flawless. This is how God sees me. So it don't make any difference what somebody says on Facebook. Or what somebody sends me some old stupid email and shoots me down, accuses me of all kind of stuff. Listen, I got to go back to the cross and see I am free from accusation. Say, I'm holy. Say, I am flawless. And I am free from accusation. I stand approved. And so what we need to do is remind ourselves constantly, because you're going to constantly be faced with these accusing thoughts. So what do we need to do? We need 2 Timothy 2:15. We need to study to show ourselves something. We need to study to show ourselves approved. Amen. I'm going to say it again. Study to show yourself. What you going to show yourself? I stand. Say, I stand.
I stand.
Approved.
Approved.
That's right. Approved unto God. That's how God sees me. Boy, isn't that like the washing of water? That's what the word does. It just washes us, man. Shows us that's who we are. All right, now we're going to receive our offering today. If you want to help us to fulfill the vision that God has given us here at Summit Church, which includes bringing you church online. If you'd like to help support that, you can give securely by clicking the give button in the upper right-hand corner of your screen and just follow the prompts, and you can give if you so choose to do so. Thank you for joining us for Summit Church Online, and come back and check us out again.